across beds, hearts and bucks.
This is Roberto Peroni.
Good evening. For the next hour, we'll discuss some of the week's biggest business and financial related stories. This is ready for grown-ups, so prepare yourself for verbal jousting. Tonight's Super Sharp Business Panel, the Managing Director of the Wenter Business Centres, Mr. Spencer Tagg, welcome back.
Good evening.
Jonathan Davis, Wealth Manager and Broadcaster from Hertfordshire. Nice to have you back, Jonathan.
Hello,
and,
Roberto.
And Roger Dells from the Ashridge Business School. Roger, good to see you again.
Thank you very much. Nice to be here.
I thought we were going to start with the EU and Bank of England and all that malarkey, but no. Listener Jenny, good evening to you.
Good evening, Roberto.
Welcome, Jenny. What is it you want to say to the panel?
I just want to say I'm so uplifted and excited to learn that Jonathan Davis is part of the panel tonight. I think I'm an absolute fan, and I cannot tell you, I'm so uplifted.
Uplifted.
And I can't wait to hear what he's got to say tonight.
I've got a fairly good idea, but it's quite a dish, Jenny.
Is he quite a dish as well?
Oh, yes.
Yes,
oh,
I've got a brilliant face for radio.
Jonathan, I think you're absolutely marvellous. I'm no expert at all, but what...
No, I think you're a brilliant expert, actually. It's so kind of you, Auntie. No, we've never met before. It's so wonderful. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Jenny, what about those people who say he's the Merchant of Doom?
Yes, but it's lovely. It's the truth.
Lovely
it
doom.
Is the truth. That's what it is.
Yeah, we all do. We all do. But you're a fan, Jenny. You're a fan.
I am a fan.
Do you want us to get a signed picture of Jonathan over to you?
No. No, it's all right.
She can get one if she follows me on Twitter. You can get a picture every day on Twitter.
Thank you, Jenny. We'll all be uplifted and excited now.
I'm fine. I'm looking forward to hearing what I love hearing what he's got to say, all his opinions, and I love it when he has a go about the bankers. All right.
Thank you, Jenny.
Bye.
Well, that's made my day, Roberto. That's made my week.
I'm in your shadow. Having said that, I have a Jenny in my life as well, so she won't be phoning up this evening, but so she may be listening.
All right.
Yeah, my mother's on line three.
Look, the phone number, 03459 455 555. You can talk to the panel. Ross Spencer Tagg, Jonathan Davis, Roger Dells. We will start with Jenny. We'll have to discuss this messy business that's brewing between messy business of Europe, business and politics. The governor of the Bank of England, Mark Carney, has said Britain's membership of the European Union has reinforced, and I quote, the dynamism of the UK economy. In a letter to the Commons Treasury Committee, he said he also helped the economy to grow. Now, the Conservative MP, Jacob Rees-Mogg, who wants the UK to leave the EU, told Mr. Carney it was, and I quote here, beneath the dignity of the Bank of England to be making speculative pro-EU comments. Roger, this is becoming a very bitter battle between everybody really. It's like a civil war.
Yeah, I think it's right what Jacob is saying, that speculative pro-EU comments or anti-EU comments, if you're in positions of authority, aren't helpful. Mark Carney's saying the bank won't take sides in the referendum campaign, and yet what he's saying is clearly taking a side. I think the problem for the Bank of England is the financial sector in general, big business in particular, is probably got most at risk if we exit the EU. 60% of employment in the UK is through SMEs, and it's the big business that's got most money involved and is most at risk. Carney's trying to exert some kind of subtle public pressure, but I think he got the pressure bit right and the subtle bit wrong.
But he did say the bank would not take sides in the referendum campaign. All he said was that the EU has reinforced the dynamism of the UK economy.
But that's taking sides.
But if that's the truth, is that taking sides?
Well, if it's the truth. But the anti-European people would say, well, that's actually not true. So the problem with this is it's so full of subjective comment. So unless he's going to back that up with facts and figures and say, this is why I believe this to be the case, and then somebody else will refute those facts and figures and say, well, actually, no, that's not the case. So whenever somebody in a position of public authority says something about this and they put the weight of their institution behind what they say, they've got to be really, really careful, because institutions shouldn't take sides, because there will be dissenting voices within the institution that have an equal and opposite point of view.
Spencer Tang.
I think the bit that's missing there, as you say, is the facts and the figures. So this sort of like this headline is put out there. So whether it's right or wrong that Carney should or shouldn't have made that comment, the bit that's lacking is the to substantiate the evidence behind it for then a counter argument to then ensue. And I, that's the issue I've got. I mean, I was listening to Lawson on the
Nigella's dad.
Yeah, that's right. and he was sort of disgusted with his behaviour. I'm less het up about that bit, but what I am het up about is that we're not being given and in charge of the balance facts for us to make an informed decision.
See, I don't have a view at all on Europe, but is the governor of the Bank of England, if he says that it's reinforced the dynamism of the UK economy, how much more does he need to say?
Yeah, but he's also said that there's a number of financial institutions that are based in the UK that would leave if we leave the EU. So who are those institutions? And what are the reasons for leaving? And is there then, are we able to then come up with a counter-argument to address the reasons that they feel that they would need to leave? If the answer to that is no, then maybe then it's quantifiable that actually it would cost us for exit.
Jonathan Davis.
Just last week, I was in fact in the House of Commons making a speech about small and medium-sized enterprises who are detrimentally affected by the EU, whereas the large multinationals, the big banks, love the EU because the EU loves big business. Mark Carnage, as I call him, cannot be trusted. Because he's an ex-managing director of Goldman Sachs, the most influential investment bank in the world, and B, because for the last 3 years, he's been telling the great British public that he's going to raise interest rates. And you know, Roberto, that I've been here many times saying the chances of that happening are more than finding Elvis alive in Alpha Centauri. And he got people to make bad financial decisions to fix their mortgages when in fact long-term mortgage rates kept falling. This guy cannot be trusted. I don't care, he's meant to be in an independent position.
We are told that he is the best of the best.
If you look around the world, look at the European Central Bank, the Federal Reserve, the Bank of England, the Bank of Italy, etc., etc., it's amazing. Goldman Sachs got a finger in every pie, and they do not act for the benefit of the people, they act for the benefit of the big banks, and he is still working for his previous employer. We cannot trust the guy, and it is simply absolute arrant nonsense when he says that the EU has reinforced the dynamism of the UK economy. I could come up with 1,000 figures to show that is arrant nonsense.
Okay, we've got this comment today by Mark Carney and the response by Jacob Rees-Mogg. Then we had a few days ago the former director of the British Chambers of Commerce, John Langworth, saying he wasn't forced to resign after being suspended for saying he supported Britain leaving the EU. This is becoming very, very messy. Roger, I mean, do you have an opinion? I mean, can business and industry have an opinion on the EU in or out? Because it's becoming very tetchy. John Longworth lost his job.
Yeah, again, I think the point about John Longworth is you can't speak on behalf of the British Chamber of Commerce. You can only speak as John Longworth individual. And you have to be absolutely crystal clear. It's like the row in Boris's office at the moment. Boris is saying, when you're on official business as my deputy mayor, you have to, at the very least, not disagree with me. And if you're going to disagree with me, you have to make it very clear you are speaking as a private individual on your own time. Now, that seems to me to be a reasonable position to take. If you're going to represent the organisation that pays you, that whole organisation has got to share the view that you put. So I can't sit here and say, Ashridge thinks this or Ashridge thinks that, because I don't know what Ashridge thinks.
What does Roger Delft think?
My view is that we are better staying in than exiting, but that's my personal view, it's not my institution's view. If I were to suggest that that's my institution's view, or was not to make it clear that it's not my institution's view, I am potentially misleading people. Okay. And I think that's what John's problem was, that he was, whether a advertently or inadvertently, he was suggesting that that was the view of the British Chamber of Commerce. And that's not fair, because people are desperate for a sense of direction, a sense of what should I think about this. And the Chamber of Commerce is a very influential organisation.
Spencer?
But I thought Longworth made it clear that he was saying his own views, but maybe he said that afterwards
it was post hoc, yeah.
But I think there is a difference to the Carney situation, that Longworth is actually head of a membership organisation. And again, so it wasn't wise for him to give that view, but I'm just trying to put it in some context, though. The fact that he is heading up something and representing and reflecting members' views... Although, again, I accept
is
that.
He?
well, that's just it. Where is the evidence? So if he makes that comment, if he says, you know what, we've got 35,000 membership and 87% of them, or whatever the evidence is, then that adds some weight to his comment. Yeah. And that's the bit that's lacking, both with Garney and...
Will we get the evidence as we get closer towards the referendum date? Because at the moment there's a lot of rhetoric. It's sort of...
I worry that we will, in actual fact. I really hoped, when they announced the date of the referendum...
You were expecting a barrage of facts and figures.
Or a programme on Channel 4 or a great broadcaster like the BBC to put on a half hour before and a half hour afterwards, and we can make an informed decision.
Well, there will be a big programme before, I think a week or two before the election. I think
what figures is it you're wanting? When you say will we get the figures, what figures are you talking about?
Is Britain better off in or out of Europe, Jonathan?
No one's talking about leaving Europe. J'adore l'Europe. Je déteste l'Union Européenne. We're talking about leaving a political dictatorship which run by unelected bureaucrats in the slowest growing economic bloc in the world. So we're talking about leaving the EU. We will continue the trade that we have. I mean, the idea that we won't be able to sell Minis to Germany, it's made by BMW, for goodness sake, and so on and so on. The trade will continue, but on top of that, we'll do trade deals with the second largest economy on the planet, China. We'll have our own one with America. We'll do one again with the Commonwealth. Remember New Zealand butter, which had to stop 20 years ago? We'll have all that business, and we'll have the current business.
So you're an undecided, are you?
Now, what I think is interesting about... there's a very strong assertion of a point of view.
Yeah.
What would be interesting would be to say to, let's say, the Chamber of Commerce, there's a very strong assertion of a point of view. What percentage of the people in the Chamber of Commerce agree with that point of view, and what percentage disagree?
Oh, we know 60% of the BCC are to remain.
Let me take some troubles and come back with tonight's panel. And you want to take part, you know how to contact the programme. 18 minutes past six. My panel tonight, Spencer Tagg, Jonathan Davis, and Roger Dells. Roger, just to remind listeners what it is you do at the Ashridge Business School.
Well, Ashridge is now merged with Holt International Business School, so we're the world's largest graduate business school. My job there is to run the Ashridge qualifications programs, the programs that are associated with degrees at the end of them. And we've got, 9 or 10 of those that we offer. And Holt have got a whole range of other degree programs that they offer. So that's what I do. I work on degree programs across Ashridge and Holt.
And if you're looking for a fantastic place to work, Ashridge is pretty cool.
It's beautiful. Yeah, we're up there with the deer in the hills.
It's pretty stunning. Jonathan, you're an independent wealth manager and a bit of broadcasting as well, happening as well.
Well, it's very nice of you to mention it. I've started a few weeks ago my own radio show. It's essentially about capitalism versus socialism. And it's on talktomeradio.com. And it's growing very rapidly. We're going live from 2 p.m. next Monday. Every Monday, 2 p.m., talktomeradio.com.
Good, very well done. Spencer, Winter Business Centres, you run these business centres across the three counties, indeed parts of London as well.
Yes, indeed, Enfield. We're home to about 260-odd businesses across the counties. So we're operating large buildings, subdivided to smaller offices and workshops, very much aimed at that small, the SME marketplace, but very much the commercial activity that we're generating supports the social enterprise of Winter, where we have a range of business support programs to help startups, pre-startups. We engage with schools and colleges to very much inspire enterprise and help youngsters into the place.
Look, we've been talking to Winter for the last couple of years since we had the downturn, the recession. It was a clear indicator of what business was doing. We see, Jonathan might disagree, we seem to be doing okay. Is that represented in the sort of businesses that are coming to you?
Yeah, I would. But the emphasis seems to be doing okay, because I think there are some fragile elements to that growth and that prosperity. It's not as robust as I think many of us would like. But nevertheless, as a market, there's lots of things happening out there, and I think there's a lot of growth.
Okay. Gentlemen, is the cost of borrowing set to fall further? I know we've kind of briefly touched upon this, but the interest rates will likely fall further in Britain and remain at near record low levels until 2021. A former Monetary Policy Committee member says David Blanchflower was on the MPC in 2009 when quantitative easing was first introduced and rates were cut to 0.5%. He says growth in Britain is still very weak and the global economy feels a little bit like 2008. If this carries on, will we end up being paid to borrow money, Jonathan?
Effectively, what you're asking is, will we have negative interest rates? First thing I want to say is that most people believe that the Bank of England decides our interest rates. It only decides one rate, which is the very short term, we call the overnight rate, the bank rate, 0.5%. That is effectively the rate at which companies and banks lend to the government. Now, when companies and governments lend to the UK government over, say, 10 or 20 years, they get an interest rate. And if you lend to Switzerland over the next 15 years, it's negative. Lend to Germany, it's negative. Lend to the European Central Bank, 28 countries, it's negative. We currently have a 0.5% base rate, but if you lend to the UK over 10 years, it's about 1.5% interest. So to answer the question is, it is very likely the way the market is going, interest rates are continuing to be driven down. They've been going down for 35 years. They continue to be driven down. And yes, we will see negative rates in the UK right across the West. It shows we are in deflation, which is to some people's way of thinking a dreadful state of affairs. I love it because my business and living costs go down. And yes, we will have negative interest rates, and it is quite the worst thing that we could possibly have. But that's what they will do.
Why is it the worst thing? Negative interest rates means it costs less to borrow money to buy a house or a car.
The idea of having negative interest rates is the central banks believe that it will force banks and bond societies to lend more money. It won't. What it will do is it will make people hoard their cash, because of course £100 today will still be £100 tomorrow. But in fact, if we have negative interest rates, they'll actually have made a positive return on it, because if they put it in the bank, they'd have got a negative return. So they'll hoard cash. Negative interest rates is actually forcing deflation. And amazingly, that's what central banks around the world are doing right now. It's both mad and bad, but it's coming.
Roger, I thought it was going to be a case of they're going to give you 50 quid to borrow £10,000 to buy a car. Not quite the case, it would seem.
Well, I think one of the challenges here is the difference between listening to an economist who understands what's going on and being a consumer who doesn't really understand what's going on. I mean, for consumers, what they see is very, very, very little return on saving. So what they say is, there is no point in me saving. So if I'm not going to save, if I have any spare cash, I'll spend it, I'll enjoy it, I will put it back into the economy by buying things that whether it's a holiday, whether it's a car, whether it's a more white goods, more brown goods, whatever it might be. The problem with storing up for the future then is people don't have money saved, and when they discover their pension is insufficient, they have nothing else to fall back on, and then we put more pressure on social services, which are already overstretched, and we're hoarding up problems for the future. So there's no easy solution. And one of the other problems we have is that when people get used to spending, they then begin to spend, when they run out of ready cash, as it were, they then begin to spend on credit cards. And then when people do put money into the economy, what people do with that money is they have to pay off credit card debt. So what you're then doing is you're putting money into the economy, which then goes straight back to the banks, because you're using it to pay off interest on credit cards.
You sound like an economist. Jonathan, you want to come back to that?
I just want to say that the problem is that as a society, we've borrowed too much over the last 20 or 30 years. We are now in the fallout of the biggest debt explosion in history, and unfortunately, the policymakers' actions is to continue doing what they've been doing. The problem is, it isn't working, and it's still not going to be working. What we need is a total reversal of policy.
Spence, it's kind of baffling. It's kind of, the interest rates are falling. It's record lows. I thought we'd be celebrating.
Yes, and the headline gives you that impression, doesn't it? And clearly, there's a lot underneath that is sort of like the counter-argument, the dichotomy of it all. In actual fact, so whilst I'm in the shadow of knowing that detail and the actual effects of it, but I can certainly echo the earlier statements that, and I made reference to it when you're talking about how's life at Wendra and all the small businesses, and I made reference that it's fragile, and it's because of that world economy, and we look at the performance of China and that slowdown. Excuse me. And the oil prices, everyone again thinks, it's great, it's cheaper to fill up my car, but the sort of the ripple effect of all that and lack of investment in shale gas alternatives and all that type of thing is just having a huge effect. It's just the unintended consequences, I guess, of what looks like a great headline, deflation, but an actual fact behind it is some serious consequences.
Jonathan, what should the average homeowner or the average man and woman in Britain who's working hard to pay the bills, what should they be doing with this low interest rates, big problems in the world economy? What should they do to protect themselves?
You know, 30 or 40 years ago, if you borrowed as much as you possibly could in a high inflation environment, then 20 years later, your wages earnings have risen so much, your borrowings have gone down relative to your income. But the fact is, average incomes haven't risen for years, and relative to inflation, they're even behind over 20 years. My point being, if you've been borrowing an enormous amount of money to, for example, to buy property in the last few years, that debt's still there. You haven't paid it back. It's still there. And in 10 years' time, in a no inflation, or even worse for a debtor, a deflation environment, you'll actually owe more than you borrowed in the first place. So the answer to your question is, people absolutely have to do whatever they can to get out of debt.
Well, hang on a minute. We all seem, a lot of people are probably thinking, my house is my pension, is my fortune. House prices will keep on rising.
Well, it used to be. It's no longer the case. And I say to you that I will be surprised if in 10 years' time house prices are any higher than they are today. I think it's more likely they'll be lower than they are today.
Roger, do you agree with him?
I think it's a persuasive argument. I think it will depend on where you are in the country. I think it's unlikely to be true in London, but I think it could certainly be true in many other parts of the country. And I think that the big challenge that people will have overall is exactly as Jonathan says. People's long-term debt is not going to reduce significantly, and nor is their short-term debt, because they've got this credit card debt mounting up against them, where they're able to pay down the interest each month, but not much more than that. They're not able to pay down much more of the capital. So people are caught in this trap where all they're doing is managing the interest on the debt, on the short-term debt, and the long-term debt really isn't reducing either. The value of the house is either static or only creeping up if you're outside of London, and that's likely to change. People aren't earning money on their money, earning interest on their money, because there's no interest to be earned on money. And people really get desperate just to find a way out of that sort of trap. They start taking silly risks, or they start despairing that there is any way out at all. And I think that, you know, the volatility of the markets and the uncertainty of the markets is something that we ordinary consumers are utterly unused to having to deal with. And we really do, I think, want and need better advice. And this is where we get back to the Bank of England and Carney and other people, where the advice seems to be at best equivocal and at worst contradictory from month to month. And people are just desperately confused, I think.
We'll take some troubles to come back with tonight's panel. Spencer Tang, Jonathan Davies, Roger Delves, and Daz. I will read your text next, I do promise. Tonight's panel, Jonathan Davies, Wealth Manager from Hertfordshire, Roger Dells from the Ashford Business School, and Spencer Tang, Managing Director of the Wenta Business Centre. Before we go back to the sort of thing, we'll lighten up a little bit, I promise. Daz on the Texas Rock. We spoke earlier on to the lady who was organising the funeral of Ron Bean. in Letchworth, this gentleman, 86-year-old Navy veteran, passed away with nobody, no family left. So the Royal British Legion got in contact with us, and they got in contact with Facebook, and they organised some people, quite a few people to be there, and a bugler as well. And Dan says, Rob, I've just attended Ron Bean's funeral. Like most there, I didn't know him, but it lifts your heart that so many were there to see off an ex-serviceman. Dad, thank you for going. Thank you to everyone who went along. William Rondine did not leave this mortal coil on his own. He went out with a bit of honour and dignity. And thank you for those people. Did go for a lot of the 300 listeners. I do appreciate it. Now, back to our story. We've been quite heavy. Let's line up with a little bit. Could we have workplace etiquette, gentlemen? What's your view on eating at the desk, or in your car, or in the lorry, or indeed wherever you work? So-called desktop diners are a common sight in many busy offices. Just over half of us apparently regularly work through our lunch breaks, a BBC study has found. In the US, more than three-quarters of workers regularly eat at their desk, according to research by the Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics. They say it's a question of time, and I mean, anywhere to go. Spencer, does it put you off when you see people eating at their desk?
Even though I do it, yeah, I much prefer that if an environment did exist that everyone could go to a rest area, wouldn't that be so great? But the reality is that the workplace is a changing environment, and it's a very different place today than it was only a short time ago, let alone some years previous. But I was reading with interest only a couple of weeks back about how Google, for example, and part of their sort of getting serendipity and getting people to sort of bump into one another, they offer free meals at lunchtime or indeed all day, and they actually create an environment that people have to queue up. And they manage it, so they're actually deliberately getting a bit of a queue, so people talk to people in the queue, so they don't want it to be the service too fast. So quite specifically, they don't want people sitting at their desk and just rushing and carrying on. They want people to get up from their desk.
Yeah, but they're the exception. Google and Facebook and Amazon and Twitter.
Of course.
Because they've got so much money, they don't know how to spend it.
Well, they don't pay the tax. They're all right.
come to that.
Yeah, of course. Yeah, and I refer to that as a bit of visionary. That, yeah, clearly the small firm employing eight people couldn't replicate that by any stretch. But conceptually, though, to be thinking, wouldn't it be so good to move away from a culture that people are grabbing a quick sarnie over the while they're doing something else, and maybe having quality time to separate and actually away from their workstation?
If it's eight people, as you said, you imagine, right? Should those eight people make a point of stepping outside the workplace for half an hour, go to a pub, and be together and eat away from where they work?
Ideally, yes, but I'm not naive to the fact that's not always possible.
Roger, am I right? The Ashridge Business School has a rather nice restaurant.
Yeah, we're very privileged. I mean, we're able to, as staff, we can go to staff hall. The clients have got the client dining room to go to. But we also have people who will eat at their desk and can take food back from the staff hall to their desk. It's not a habit I like, partly because, you know, you eat the food, but the memory lingers. You walk into somebody's office after they brought food back to their office and you're aware of it in the air, as it were. So I don't particularly like that, and I try not to do it in my own office. It's a meal of last resort if I'm eating a sandwich at my desk. I like to get out, even if it's only 15 minutes, to go and eat somewhere else so that I don't have that sense of food around me all afternoon.
It's a very British, perhaps a more American thing, that you're there, you work hard, you don't stop. Whereas mainland Europe, maybe why they have so many problems, they do take a break, coffee breaks, a lot of them, and they stop for lunch.
Yeah, I mean, today I had lunch with somebody and we chatted through some work-related things. So I wasn't not working, I was simply doing it in an environment where I could eat the food, sat at a table with somebody else, and it wasn't my desk, so my room wasn't going to smell of the food we'd eaten all afternoon. So it's not so much for me about not working over lunch, it's about having lunch somewhere where I'm not going to be spending the rest of my afternoon working.
Okay, Jonathan.
Well, I'm normally pretty good with the zeitgeist, what's happening in the 21st century, but what does it mean, a lunch break? What was that?
Let me just explain to you. This is where you stop making money for an hour and you take a break. I know you wealth managers carry on making wealth.
He's just showing off.
It's just the money. You take a break occasionally, Jonathan.
Look, those people who are listening who run their own businesses will know that time is money. And there are 101 things to do. And I, for my part, I often have breakfast and lunch, not at the same time, at my desk, and for colleagues, for staff, it's a time to have a break, to catch up on emails, even personal emails, book the holiday, check out what's happening on the TV that night, and so on. So I think it's entirely appropriate for the 21st century that we should have our lunch at our desks in front of our computers.
Have Labour got the right approach to business, gentlemen? Labour are to unveil this week a series of billboard-style adverts attacking the government for failing to raise more tax from Google. You raised a bit point there. This, of course, comes just days after Facebook announced a major overhaul of its tax structure, which should result in the social media giant paying millions of pounds more tax in the UK. Are all politicians coming to this a little bit late, Spencer?
Yes, it is too late for some and too little too late. But whilst I'm not necessarily advocating this approach, but clearly we're only got to where we are now because of this raising the profile. So this method is going to embarrass these large companies to do the right thing morally, because again, they're not doing anything illegally, and I haven't suggested otherwise, but we want them to really step up and do the right thing morally and contribute to their society.
Labour got the budget next week, and we may talk about that before 7, but Labour are going to unveil a series of billboard-style adverts trying to encourage these big corporate giants to pay more tax. Is that perhaps the approach they should be taking?
Well, that specifically, I don't think that's the right approach. But if you're asking me, do we raise the profile of these organisations? I remember when it was first about Starbucks, and there was a bit sort of that people power that for a time people voted with their feet and chose to walk past the Starbucks into the Cafe Nero, only to find out perhaps that they're not.
Let me just update you on Cafe Nero, because they have paid no corporation tax in the last financial year, despite a profit of £23.6 million. The company, which has hundreds of branches across Britain, saw sales in the UK and Ireland grow by 8.5% to £241 million to the end of May 2015, but somehow they paid no corporation tax whatsoever. I need to talk to their accountants rapidly. Yeah.
And I think that there is some differences between online businesses and retail businesses. And if we're just looking on retail business, it's not fair that an independent cafe operator, again, that small business, has to pay a far higher rate of tax than the Cafe Nero next door, which isn't contributing on anywhere near the scale, person for person, that is, that the independent next door.
Roger, the problem is, of course, it's a balancing act, because you don't want to scare off companies, but you want them to stay and make money, but also pay tax.
Yes, I think it's about fairness, and I think that the successive governments have basically bent the knee to these big corporations in order to make sure that they came to this country and they continued to trade and be successful and all the rest of it. And we've also got the balance wrong, because the revenue pursues individuals and small businesses to the ends of the earth and beyond for £150, whilst these big corporations are allowed to get away
I do hear that line from many businesses when we talk on this programme about, you know, I have been chased by the revenue, can't they chase Google, or in this case Cafe Nero, it would seem.
And as when you hear the revenue saying, well, these are highly complex tax cases and they're very specialist people who need to pursue them, train more people, get your people more skilled in pursuing where the big money lies, because that would help us a great deal more than having lots of people pursuing small businesses for a few hundred. Pursue the big businesses for the few million, and things would look brighter much quicker.
And what do you think of these billboard campaigns that Labour are going to launch this week?
Oh, I mean, it's utterly misguided.
Pay more tax, please.
Utterly misguided. I mean, it's just a mistake. I mean, it's the wrong time, it's the wrong target. It's just a mistake.
Jonathan?
It's entirely two-faced as well of Labour, because it was Gordon Brown who drew up the tax laws that we have that allow the international companies to basically get away with paying no or very little tax. However, I should say, if I were the chief executive of Google UK or Facebook UK, I would want to pay as little tax as I possibly could. Don't blame the companies, blame the politicians. George Osborne has been Chancellor now for nearly 6 years, and he's done absolutely nothing about it. I mean, that £130 million from Google was a drop in the ocean. It is an absolute outrage that you can do business on the UK mainland, make profits, and not pay tax on it. An absolute outrage. It needs to be sorted, and we need to do it unilaterally. Whether or not we will is another matter.
Do we chase these big corporates for...
We change the tax laws.
Hang on. Do we chase them for everything they should legally... They've done nothing wrong, but should we chase them more? Or if they make a voluntary contribution, a bit more than £130 million, should we accept it and say thank you very much?
We should accept it, of course, but that's entirely not the point. They're doing it to try and win some popularity with the public, and you know, that's their marketing spin, fair enough. Don't blame the companies, blame the politicians, whether it's Labour or Conservative. They're on the side of the multinationals, as indeed is the EU, to the detriment of SMEs.
But yes, so there's a lot of tidying up to be done, but I still think, and again, I'm not advocating this specific approach of billboards, but by raising the profile, then consumers, so you're saying blame politicians, but also we need to blame consumers. The day that actually then, because it's very quick for a consumer to say, oh, I can't get an appointment at my doctor's, oh, it's all these foreigners coming in. But in actual fact, if they were to say, I'm not going to use Facebook anymore because they're not paying tax to contribute to the welfare system or the health service.
Yeah, we won't do that because we're hooked.
No, yeah, we're hooked. But I'm saying is we've got to take some responsibility. So and to inform the consumer that these organisations aren't paying their way.
But they've done nothing wrong. They're working entirely legally within. In fact, Mr. Osborne's family firm, Osborne & Little, I think they haven't paid a corporation tax for 8 years.
Yeah, but they haven't done anything wrong legally, but morally they should be contributing a lot more than what they're doing at the moment.
If depending on how Britain votes on the 23rd of June, if the British electorate vote to leave the EU, would that change the tax laws? Would we be able to impose greater tax penalties on these companies and corporations, right? Or would they just leave?
Well, if we leave the EU, we would have more freedom to create tax laws without worrying about whether or not they were aligned with the EU tax laws. So as far as that goes, yes, we could. However, the other side is exactly as you say. If we're out of the EU, would these organisations headquarter in the UK? I don't know. But certainly, the more independent we are, the more freedom we have to write our own tax laws. They still have to be fair, of course. I don't think it's necessarily about writing better laws. I do think it's about imposing them more with more rigour. And although, you know, we keep on hearing these companies haven't broken the law, I don't think we know that that's necessarily true. They haven't been investigated closely enough for us to be sure that that's true.
Or it could be that if the British electorate vote to leave, Jonathan, the EU, we could lower the tax, make it even more agreeable for these companies to stay.
Maybe we could. The big picture issue is that if the great British public vote to leave the EU on the 23rd of June, we would be able to take control over our laws. At the moment, 75% of our laws derive from unelected bureaucrats in Brussels.
We'll take some travel news to come back with tonight's panel. Jonathan Davis, Spencer Tagg, Roger Delves. You can text the programme 81333. Start your text 3CR. Spencer Tagg, Jonathan Davis, Roger Delves. There's another text for you here, Jonathan. I'll find it. Oh, Mark says, if Jonathan Davis drops me a tenner, I'll phone him with more compliments.
Then he'll be waiting a long time.
Oh dear. Right, let's get back to this. So it's about light and shade, isn't it? About mixing it all up. Gentlemen, does it really matter how many jobs you have? An Oxford University educated professor has been working as a porn star in our films. Way to relieve the stress of a divorce, it has emerged, I'm quoting it. Nicholas Goddard has taught chemical engineering at the University of Manchester for almost 25 years, but for the last decade, he has also been starring as Old Nick in dozens of adult films, according to the Sun newspaper. Professor Goddard has published many scientific papers over his 35-year career and is the lead tutor on three courses. So clearly, he is very good at one job. He also appears to be very good, I'm told, at his other job. Does it matter how many jobs you have, Roger?
No, look, I'm full of admiration for the man. I mean, I'm an Oxford University educated man, and I've got my own series, you know, Podgy Roger, The Naked Truth. And I've had nothing like the success that Old Nick has had. And I think probably I'm just going for the wrong target market. But I mean, you know, fair play to him.
You've written a book. You've written a couple of books.
Yep. I've written chapters of various books, and I've written a book with a colleague of mine, Sona Sherritt, called 50 Management Dilemmas. One of them was not about making porn movies, to say, but still. But that's part of the, I mean, that's part of the same job. Because it's about business. So it's not quite as divergent as this particular job that he's decided to go for.
Spencer Tagg.
Your question is there a limit or is it okay to have more than one job? My response would be, as long as the other work does not have a conflict with the other work.
I don't think it doesn't.
Yeah.
Say no. Chemical engineering and starring as old Nick there is no conflict there.
Well, isn't there? I mean, morality. You're sending your young people to go to college and university, and you've got someone that's involved with those sort of activities. That's I don't know. Isn't there a conflict?
Two very different subjects.
No, seriously, I think you're right. I think if I was this professor's dean, I would be saying to him, I'm not sure that's appropriate behaviour.
Yeah. So I suggest there perhaps is a question here that there could well be a conflict.
Okay. Jonathan?
I think this is such a brilliant story. Only in Britain, maybe in Italy, I should imagine, also.
In Italy, but the Prime Minister's had to run out.
Good luck to the guy. If it helps him relieve the stress, then fine. If it makes him a bit of money on the side, then why not? It's no doubt good fun. It's work, it's business, why not?
Does this story appeal to the British sense of humour? Because when I read a story like this at the weekend, maybe it's the British sense of humour, I just chuck it. I think some people might be horrified the fact that he's a university professor and he has this part-time job as a porn star. And there's some great pictures of him in the classroom. Chick trick. And then him, of course, in a very particular pose. And I'm having a good old chuckle.
Yeah, it gives a whole new meaning to pressing the flesh, doesn't it?
You could say that. You can tweet the programme at Drive With Rob. Oh, by the way, Roger, where can people follow you on social media?
I've got a Twitter account, which is at Dels Roger, and I'm on Facebook, and Ashridge, of course, is on Facebook and Twitter, and all the places you'd expect to find us.
Spencer?
At Spencer Tagg, in terms of my Twitter account, and indeed our website is wenter.co.uk.
Mr. Davis?
I'm Jonathan Davis, where the O is a zero.
Okay. We've seen a big rise in the number of new cars on the roads. Do consumers know that perhaps they might be facing a big balloon payment after they finish paying their 48 monthly instalments? New car sales grew by 8.4% in February compared to the same month last year, according to industry figures. A total of 83,395 new cars were registered in the UK last month alone. So, really fantastic. I mean, we've nearly got as many new cars on the road as we've got people in prison. There's some great adverts. You see, I mean, dealers are offering fantastic packages on these cars. Basically, you don't have to pay anything now. You don't have to pay anything for 3 months, no deposit. It's only £150 a month. But at the end of it, they sort of say you can pay an £8,000 deferred. Do they know that, Jonathan?
I think people do know that, and I think they work on the basis that they'll hand back the car after 3 years and then they'll do it over again. The big picture is that 80% of cars are bought on massive tick, and this is the new subprime lending. There's no question about that. There's no way that we'd be selling over a million new cars a year without subprime lending. If you can fog a mirror, it's like 8 years ago, if you could fog a mirror, you could borrow a mortgage at whatever you wanted, a multiple of your income. Now, if you can fog a mirror, you can buy whatever car you want. It's a wholly, hugely expensive way of transporting yourself, and people are going to come a cropper.
But it is very tempting.
And one point I want to make is this has not been tested in a recession, and it is very likely that 2016-17 is going to be a recession. I think people are going to have to hand back their cars.
Knowing a little bit about the car industry, what some people may not realise, of course, when you do give the car back after 3 or 4 years, it's just not just a question of handing it back. Every little scratch, every little nick on the app will be deducted or added to your bill. It's quite a, it can be quite a shock for some people, Spencer.
Yeah, and I was, there's the mileage limits as well.
Yeah, are, very restrictive, yeah.
Are very restrictive, yeah, sort of 8,000 miles a year, and it's sort of almost quite subtly put. So people do they understand it, and maybe
but it's
in
tempting.
The moment...
The thing is, it's very tempting.
But no, it's what Jonathan was saying earlier on, the whole culture, though, over the last 20 years, we just borrow, aren't we? And it's, yeah, let's have it today, and we worry about it tomorrow, and we're just waiting for another big crash, and it's all going to come tumbling down, or rather, the risks are high of a lot of it coming tumbling down in the near future.
So the problem is you want cars to a lot of these cars are manufactured, Toyota, for example, Nissan manufactured in, or assembled in the UK. You want those factories busy, you want those workers occupied, paying their mortgages, and you want the whole thing to follow through. But could there be, as Jonathan, a subprime problem here?
Well, yeah, I think the problem is exactly as Jonathan says, that the way they're structuring the purchasing option, they make it sound really attractive, but if you're paying £150 a month over 3 years, at the end of 3 years, you paid £5,400, and you give the car back. You're not going to get that £5,000. That £5,400 is just the cost of your motoring for 3 years. And then you've got to pay another £150 a month for the next lot. So over 6 years, you're going to pay over £10,000. You don't own anything at the end of it. You've got nothing to show for it, and that's not going to help you to manage.
No, but a car is always going to be, unless you buy something really special, is always going to be the worst investment you're ever going to make.
No, well, that's true. But you've got to be prepared to accept that unless you're going to make the balloon payment, which none of us are going to do, and I think people do understand that balloon payment thing, there are much better ways of not getting much for your money than this particular route. So you could buy a second-hand car, for example, and at least you own it. And if you choose at the end of 3 years to say, well, actually, I haven't got much money at the moment, I'm going to run this into the ground for another 3 years, at least you have that option.
The problem is, it's more expensive to buy a second-hand car, which is probably more affordable than it is to buy a brand-new car.
But if we go back a stage, and if we didn't bail out these banks every time... Hello, Jenny, are you there? If we didn't bail out these banks every time they messed up through reckless lending, there would now be tighter lending on cars, and I can assure you, Roberto, car prices would be much lower. And another point worth making, figures have just come out from the US, and we've got broadly similar lending standards as the US. Do you know the average length of term of a car loan now in the US is 5.5 years? A car doesn't last much longer than that, and yet people are paying something like £150, £200 a month. And by the way, that's at the lowest level for family-sized cars. It's more like £300 a month for 5.5 years, and then they have to pay. They just have to hand it back. That is a dreadful way of buying transportation.
And what happens if you lose your job or the market?
Exactly.
Do you just hand it back, Jonathan, halfway mid through the 3 year term?
I don't know. I think I'm right in saying that you are liable to pay the, if it's a 4 year loan, you're liable to pay the 4 year payments. If you lose your income, you're stuffed.
I think the point Jonathan makes about the banks is well worth reiterating. I mean, one of the things about capitalism that's gone badly wrong over the last few years is that if a bank makes money, the profits are privatised, they're kept within the banks. But if it makes a huge loss, suddenly those profits are publicised and become part of the public purse. And that's not what capitalism was supposed to be at all.
I just have to make a very quick point. That's exactly the point, Roger. It's not capitalism. If a business goes bust, you let it go. You let
Absolutely.
It fail. Yep. It's not capitalism. People say capitalism has failed. We haven't had capitalism for 30 years.
Yeah. No, I agree. The point I'm making is exactly that. That isn't capitalism, okay. And we need to get back to a clearer definition of what capitalism should be.
Very briefly, because we're about to come to the end of the program. It is the budget next week. I can't wait myself. Spencer, what are you expecting from the budget?
What I'm expecting, or what I wish for, I mean, I think we're going to get lots of rhetoric and stuff, and whether it is reducing that top rate of tax and all that type of thing, the Middle England we're going to hear about. But would I like to see, again, we made an earlier reference to tax, so simplification of tax processes would be great and very timely. I mean, the support for small businesses, whether it's an incentive for innovation investments, business rate relief and stuff. So there's a lot that could be done.
Roger? Anything you're particularly hoping for in next week's budget?
But I'd echo what Spencer's saying. I mean, one of the things we talk about at Ashridge a lot at the moment is what they call this VUCA environment. It's volatile, it's uncertain, it's complex, and it's ambiguous. And I think if the budget can do anything to help address any of those VUCA elements for consumers, it would be tremendous. I doubt it will. I think it's going to be about helping people decide what they're going to do in June.
I think you're absolutely right, Roger. In my wildest dreams, however, we would close down the Bank of England, we would stop government borrowings, and we would let the market set interest rates. But of course, it's never going to happen.
You'd be a very entertaining governor of the Bank of England.
Yeah.
It wouldn't last very long, but we'd be very entertaining.
Your wildest dreams are different to old Nick's, though, aren't they?
Gentlemen, thank you.